The 1940s. World War II was raging in Europe and the Pacific Rim. Benjamin O. Davis was appointed a Brigadier General, the first black general in American history. The minimum wage in America is 43 cents per hour, and the average life expectancy for white males in America is 62 years. However, for non-white males, 51 years. Lucy Byard dies in Washington, D.C. after being denied treatment at the Adventist Hospital only because she was black. The outrage of black Seventh-day Adventists forced the General Conference to deal seriously with the question of race in America and in the Adventist Church. 1 year later, in Chicago, Illinois, by an overwhelming vote of delegates, black conferences were established.
Regional conferences began to operate in the middle 1940s, when segregation was the law of the day. We use the term regional now more so than we do black, but those conferences were inaugurated in the middle 1940s for the colored people. Now, we've been several different things in the United States. We've been colored, we've been Negro, we're black, now we're African American, and several other descriptions that, depending upon where you are, we'll use. When the black conferences were organized by the General Conference in the 1940s for the colored work, they came in having to pay the same percentage of tithe into the retirement fund. And I got into the ministry in 1967. My president, Charles E. Dudley, Elder Dudley, was a man who gave the pastors free rein to think and act. And I remember him speaking repeatedly about the retirement fund being unfair to the black conferences that were trying to get started but had to pay the same percentage of their meager tithe dollars into the sustentation fund, and it would be 40 years, you had to work 40 years in order to qualify for full retirement benefits, that it would be 40 years before any appreciable number of black workers or colored workers would go on the sustentation fund. And so because of hearing that complaint by Elder Dudley and others who were leaders of our conferences after I got in the ministry in 1967. That thing was ringing in my ears over the years, and I was somewhat frustrated as to why they wouldn't do something about it or do anything about it.
More and more of the working force from the war generation were now beginning to retire. And many of them sought retirement in the South. It was here that Elder Charles Dudley was met with the challenge of trying to provide employment opportunities for these senior leaders who had already given 30 and even 40 years of faithful service. They simply could not make it on the retirement income that was provided. I can remember as conference secretary there in Allegheny East, assisting some of these workers in the filling out of their retirement application. And remember clearly looking at the bottom line and scratching my head to figure out how were they going to make it. Those, of course, who had been fully vested with 40 years may have been getting somewhere around $700 and change. But those who may have started later in ministry were getting a lot less. I know of one in particular who retired in the beginning of a certain year. His retirement was going to be about $800, including his spousal allowance. However, his spouse unfortunately passed away 6 months later. And then his income was reduced to just a little more than $600.
I started in a work in 1949. I never gave up the work. I spent 40 years in service in the Southwestern Union. That's my time in New York and also in Southwest, Western Union. After 40 years in the Southwest, I came down here and spent 8 years pastoring and also working in Wills and Trusts. Well, when they were retired, the General Conference was giving them money to live on. That's what they thought. But they tell me that when you become an Adventist minister, you take a vow of poverty. I didn't know that. I didn't take any vow of poverty. I didn't know that that's what the brethren was saying. So they paid the brethren a stipend or whatever you might want to call it, because it wasn't no salary. But when I got into the ministry, one of the ministers died. And when he died, the brethren from the General Conference said, "We cannot give her his sustentation because she's not old enough." And when she wasn't old enough, because she was in her 50s, and they didn't give her no sustentation. We had to hire her in the church school there in Dallas to sustain herself until she reached 62. Well, I thought within myself that the Congress voted down Social Security. And I told the brother, I was sitting on a conference committee, I told him, "Listen, if the shoe fits, then I got to wear it. I have to be able to provide for my family and my children if I should die. So therefore, I'm going to get involved in the Social Security program, even though you are turning it down, because I see that they will give my widow, if I die, benefits until they finish college, if they wanted to go to college. So therefore, I decided to get into Social Security. So that was my salvation. The conference turned it down, and it didn't make it mandatory until the end of my ministry. But I was in it from the very beginning, because I saw the benefits of Social Security.
If you opted out of Social Security, then you didn't. All you had to rely on was this $840 a month plus the spousal allowance. Well, I retired some 5 years ago, my wife and I, and I think for 30 plus years of labor at Oakwood College, I received somewhere in the area of $700+, which they took out for insurance, 100 plus of those dollars, which leaves me right today at about $625, plus I get my Social Security. Now, again, I say, if I had opted out of Social Security, I don't know where I would be. But my main concern is with the guys who are coming behind. If you're going to retire, you need to make sure your bills are paid off. You don't need to retire with this little monthly allowance. If you're not on the new system, if you're going to be on the old system, then you need to get all your bills paid off, or at least paid way down where you can make it with what you're going to have to live off of, because it's not going to be very much.
concern over the inequity of the Adventist retirement plan was expressed as early as the late 1960s, early 1970s. Leaders such as Elder George Earle, the president of the Northeastern Conference, Elder Charles Dudley, the president of the South Central Conference, and even some pastors such as the late Elder Thaddeus Wilson, saw the disadvantage that employees of the regional conference had against the employees of state conferences. Because the retirement was not employee-based, but tithe-based, the conferences with discretionary income had a greater draw against the retirement, and those that had limited income, not being able to hire the additional employees, were actually subsidizing the stronger conferences. In addition, the 1980s brought on the great loss of Riverside Sanitarium and Hospital. Those who have come along in later years cannot imagine what a loss that was for Black Adventism. Growing up today, members pretty much have access to any and every institution to which they may desire to go or matriculate. But in the 40s and 50s, and even into the 60s, that was not so. Riverside was where our doctors, graduating from Meharry, and yes, the few that finished at Loma Linda, it was where they did their internship. It was where they practiced. It was the Grand Duchess of Black Adventist institutions. And experiencing that loss in 1988 was grievous. It was at this time that leaders began to really galvanize and showed a deep desire to ensure that we would not continue to lose our institutions. Shiloh Academy, my alma mater there in the city of Chicago, at one time was one of the greatest Black preparatory schools in the city of Chicago. And efforts were made to try to rehouse the academy in a better location, simply because it meant too much, not just to the constituents of Lake Region, but to Black Adventism. The highly esteemed Dr. Anna Bonton had once served as principal of Shiloh Academy. He was the curator at Fisk University's library. He is counted among those who participated in the Harlem Renaissance. So many have no idea what these institutions meant to us. If you were to ask me what was the driving force in all of this, I would have to say that in the wake of the non-participation by the many Adventist institutions in North America, the non-participation of the General Conference and the North American Division, but most especially the actuarial study and the evidence that it offered. Regional presidents, to a man, felt that there was a moral imperative here, that we had to change the situation. You don't die on every hill. But this was one that was worth dying for. And so we committed ourselves to that one aim.
It was a big deal, if we just want to use common parlance, because the General Conference is recommending something. And we have 58 conferences in the North American division in Canada. And here, 9 of the 58 are going to make a decision to go contrary to the Council of the Brethren at General Conference headquarters. That's heady stuff. I mean, you just don't jump up and do that on a Sunday afternoon if you're Adventist. And you have to also deal with the politics of this, you know. We don't like to talk about politics, and we at council don't be political, but anytime you have to vote to put somebody in office, that's a political act. And people don't like to be fired. You want to do what it takes to be re-elected. Now, if you are in disfavor with the General Conference, and that is communicated to your members, then your stature is going to be reduced in their eyesight because you're going against the General Conference. So there was a huge burden on us to educate our people as to what the issues really were. And most of our members, the overwhelming majority of them, when they understood what the issues were, they were with us. So 8 of the 9 regional conferences, via constituency meetings and conference committee meetings, voted for the leaders to sign off on the document. I never will forget, when I first took this to my executive committee, one executive committee member sitting right across the table from me, because I didn't sit at the head of the table, I sat in the middle so I could be close to everybody and hear what everybody was saying on the other side. At the end of the table, you can't hear what's on the other end. But this brother was sitting right in front of me, and he said, "Elder, it's a great idea, but that's an exercise in futility. That will never happen." And I remember saying to him, "Well, I will hear strike 3, because I'm going down swinging on this one." And so the committee voted overwhelmingly, and I have to salute the people that I was serving at that time. I have to salute them. I have to salute, and I'm talking about the South Central Conference, I have to salute my predecessor, Elder Charles E. Dudley, who in all of us when we were young pastors created within us or allowed us, gave us room to be ourselves and to act on what we believed was right without any presidential pressure on us to do something a specific way. And if we decided, if we came up with something new, he would always say, "Well, let's try it. If it doesn't work, we'll try something else." Okay? And that was consistent with what my parents had taught me as a boy. You stand for the right if you have to stand by yourself. If it's right, you have to stand up for it. You're obligated to stand up for it. There were black leaders at Union and General Conference positions, division positions, who were telling various of our black conference presidents that they were damaging their career to go to advance in the work, to go up to the General Conference, and all those kinds of things. And so that's pressure, man. That's pressure. But then when the General Conference really found out we were serious about doing it, then they wanted to meet. But in my particular instance, everything I did, I sent them a copy of. I had a feasibility study, an actuarial study done, sent them all the documentation on it. They didn't read it. Those are the things that we had to deal with, man, and some of the leaders in union conferences. Some of them were presidents and some of them were secretaries of these unions. They were being encouraged by the people in the majority community, or the white people, let's just say what it is, to put pressure on us, the black leaders, not to continue with the down the road we were going. And so that was huge to overcome. They didn't think we were going to stick together, and we did. They didn't think we were going to hold up the money, and we did. They didn't think we were going to be able to get our people to go with us, and they did. So all of the things that they thought that we were not going to be able to do, we were able to do it. And I have to say this, and I repeat it every time I tell this story. There's absolutely no way that any of us could have been so smart and know the time so well to devise this plan. I believe it is an act of God, and I believe that He used the instruments who were willing to be used at that time to pull it off. And so I'm absolutely comfortable with what we did. I don't like some of the knocks that we had to take in order to get it done, but that's the price you pay for leadership.
On December 26, 1999, all nine regional conference presidents received certified letters from Elder Jan Paulsen, summoning us to a meeting with him in his office on January 4 with Elder Tom Lemon, Treasurer of the General Conference, Elder Matthew Bediako, Secretary of the General Conference, Elder Don Snyder, President of the North American Division, Elder Harold Baptiste, Secretary of the Division, Elder Juan Prestall, Treasurer of the Division, and all nine Union Presidents. This was going to be a very serious meeting. I scheduled a conference call meeting to confirm the letters that we had received and decide what we should do. The presidents felt that if we had to meet with Elder Paulsen on the 4th, that we needed to meet with our sponsor on the 3rd. And we also thought it was important that we not come alone, so we brought our officers with us as well. Each of us arrived on the 3rd and spent the entire day in prayer. We laid everything out before the Lord, and we were very transparent with one another. We did not want to put any undue pressure on any individual or in any local conference. In times past, one of our failings was that we did not always stick together. And that became a glaring weakness in our initiatives. But on this occasion, it was decided that we would stick together. And that even if an officer or a conference president or a conference was not ready to go forward with the regional retirement plan, that they would not speak against it or criticize those who did. As a result of that meeting with Elder Paulsen, a special commission was established to give study to the evidence of this alleged inequity. We met a number of times, and it was there that we decided that an actuarial study was necessary in order to validate the charges that had been made. It took a considerable amount of time for that report to be completed, almost a year. But when that report was made, all of our findings were validated. In fact, it was worse than what we thought it had been. The report provided a lot of information. It evidenced the conferences that contributed the largest per capita throughout the division. And of the top 15, all 9 regional conferences were included. This report was given to the North American Division Committee at its year-end meeting in November of 2000. And it was there decided that the regional conferences would be allowed to establish a retirement separate and apart from the North American Division retirement plan. What happened was that individuals felt that this was so negative that it was going to splinter the division. And the division president was counseled that he should call the regional presidents, call constituency meetings in their conferences, and have us put out. Leading up to the year-end meetings in November of 2000, a lot of pressure was brought to bear upon these 9 regional conference presidents. Feelings were at an all-time high, and emotions were running the gamut. I have to applaud Elder Don Snyder, who had just recently become president of the division, for the way in which he managed the multitude of issues that were coming at him. Some were counseling that constituency meetings should be held in these conferences and the regional presidents replaced. On the other hand, many felt that to do that would be the straw that would break the camel's back. I believe that Elder Snyder showed tremendous fortitude and spiritual leadership in guiding us in that process. It was a hallmark moment. The facts were there, whether individuals wanted to believe them or not. Albeit, even with the report having been given, many still did not understand. They had not lived through the experience. But in the finality, a decision was made, and the request of the regional conferences was approved. In December of 2000, at the North American Division Regional Evangelism Council, signatures were put to paper, and the regional retirement plan went into effect. To God be the glory.